Out of Africa by Isak Dinesen. I had a farm in Africa, at the foot of the Ngong Hills. The equator runs across these highlands, 100 miles to the north, and the farm lay at an altitude of over 6,000 feet. In the daytime you felt that you had got high up, near to the sun, but the early mornings and evenings were limpid and restful, and the nights were cold. The geographical position and the height of the land combined to create a landscape that had not its like in all the world. There was no fat on it and no luxuriance anywhere. It was Africa, distilled up through 6,000 feet like the strong and refined essence of a continent. The colors were dry and burnt, like the colors in pottery. The trees had a light, delicate foliage, the structure of which was different from that of the trees in Europe. It did not grow in boughs or cupolas, but in horizontal layers. The views were immensely wide. Everything that you saw made for greatness and freedom and unequaled nobility. The chief feature of the landscape and of your life in it was the feeling of having lived for a time up in the air. The sky was rarely more than a pale blue or violet, with a profusion of mighty, weightless, ever-changing clouds towering up and sailing on it. But it has a blue vigor in it. In the middle of the day, the air was alive over the land, like a flame burning. It scintillated, waved, and shone like running water. Up in this high air, you breathed easily, drawing in a vital assurance and lightness of heart. In the highlands, you woke up in the morning and thought, "Here I am, where I ought to be." We grew coffee on my farm. The land was in itself a little too high for coffee, and it was hard work to keep it going. We were never rich on the farm, but a coffee plantation is a thing that gets hold of you and does not let you go, and there is always something to do. In the wildness and irregularity of the country, a piece of land laid out and planted according to rule looked very well. Later on, when I flew in Africa and became familiar with the appearance of my farm from the air, I was filled with admiration for my coffee plantation that lay quite bright green in the gray-green land, and I realized how keenly the human mind yearns for geometrical figures. All the country round Nairobi is laid out in a similar way, and here lives a people who are constantly thinking and talking of planting, pruning, or picking coffee, and who lie at night and meditate upon improvements to their coffee factories. Coffee growing is a long job. It does not all come out as you imagine when yourself, young and hopeful, in the streaming rain, you carry the boxes of your shining young coffee plants from the nurseries, and with the whole number of farmhands in the field, watch the plants set in the regular rows of holes in the wet ground where they are to grow, and then have them thickly shaded against the sun, with branches broken from the bush, since obscurity is the privilege of young things. It is 4 or 5 years till the trees come into bearing, and in the meantime you will get drought on the land, or diseases, and the bold native weeds will grow up thick in the fields. Some of the trees badly planted with their taproots bent will die just as they begin to flower. You plant a little over 600 trees to the acre, and I had 600 acres of land with coffee. My oxen dragged the cultivators up and down the fields, between the rows of trees, many thousand miles, patiently, awaiting coming bounties. There are times of great beauty on a coffee farm. When the plantation flowered in the beginning of the rains, it was a radiant sight, like a cloud of chalk in the mist and the drizzling rain. The coffee blossom has a delicate, slightly bitter scent, like the blackthorn blossom.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.